Hello and welcome back to this, the second episode of my podcast. My name is Nathan Taylor. I'm on Ravelry as Sockmatician, and you can also find me on Twitter and Instagram and YouTube here, of course, under the same name, Sockmatician. I'm a designer and now a podcaster. This is, as I say, my second episode, and it was really, really peculiar. I had absolutely no idea how the first episode, Genesis, was going to go down. I was recording it a couple of weeks ago and just completely unaware of whether people would like it, whether people would bother to look. Well, I'm delighted to say thank you so much to everybody who watched the first episode, and maybe you're coming back for this second one as well. The response has been a little bit overwhelming, to tell you the truth. I was utterly unprepared for the level of positivity and responses coming back from people. To date, the video has had nearly 1,000 views on YouTube, which blows my mind, really blows my mind. I've had more new subscribers, so welcome if you're watching this through having subscribed on YouTube. I've made my Ravelry group a much more active and social place, which is what I wanted to do. Instagram went crazy. I had so many more followers, so welcome to all of you if you're new to me as a person, and welcome back if you're a returning visitor. So thank you all. It really has meant a lot to know that people have enjoyed listening to me prattle on and babble on and make silly mistakes, and bear with me, there'll be a few more of those along the way. So this episode I've decided to call About a Boy. Now, that's not an original title, it's a Nick Hornby book which became a film with Hugh Grant, but I feel that it's appropriate for this episode because I just wanted to go into a little bit more detail about me and what I do and who I am. People have been asking various questions on the various social media platforms, so I thought it's probably a good idea to address that now and hopefully give you guys a bit of a better idea of who I am and who this crazy bearded person is that is sitting talking to you from his sofa in North London. So, About a Boy. Again, the reason that I called it that is because I'm very much a boy knitter, and proud of that. Now, that's not to say that I want to exclude female watchers at all. That would be ridiculous. I'm so proud to be forging links with new people all the time. And the comments and the questions that have been coming in, particularly on the Ravelry forum, have been coming in from people all over the world, male and female, and that is brilliant, and I'm really, really excited about that. I said last time that the main reason I wanted to start doing a podcast was I felt I very much wanted to engage more with people, and I'm doing my best to answer as many comments and questions as I can as I go along, so bear with me if I haven't got round to saying hello yet. I will. I'll try, at least. So I mentioned last time that I am an actor and I work in musical theatre. I've been a singer all my life, and it's always been one of the most important facets of who I am as a person. My voice has always been of paramount importance to me, and I strive to be as good as I can at what I do. I'm a bit of a snob, I'm afraid, when it comes to voices and singing voices. I listen very, very closely when people are singing, and I do wish for perfection in people. I get so sick and tired of watching shows like The Voice, which should be all about the voice, where people don't really sing very well. Obviously, there are some who are amazing, don't get me wrong, but there are too many people that I feel get applauded for having, oh, this amazing voice. It's like, yeah, but can't actually sing in tune, doesn't actually have any control over the tone they're creating. All those things stress me out. I need to get over that, of course. Life is too short. But voices are important to me. I come from a family of singers. My mum has a beautiful voice. My sister is also a great singer, and I know that she and I sing mostly because of my mum. We would be in the car together as the three of us going places, just going to the shops, and we would always be singing together, singing rounds, singing nursery rhymes from a very young age. And it's because of that, that nurturing of the singing environment that I grew up in, that I know that that's the reason why I'm so passionate about singing now. I work sometimes, or at the moment I'm working part-time as a acting through song coach at a London drama college called the Erdang Academy. And I'm really, really passionate about it. I'm there as a director, not as a singing teacher. But for me, the two things are so closely linked. The idea of telling a story through song, it's not just about making beautiful noises. It's so much more than that. I feel that if you're standing on a stage and you're not telling a story, why are you there? That's my musical theatre background coming into play, I guess, because musical theatre for me is the perfect blend of storytelling and the emotions through music. So that's what I do now. I've been very, very lucky and fortunate in my career. I've done a lot of work in West End musicals. I was in my first West End show was Miss Saigon at the Theatre Royal Drury Lane, which was the most exciting thing you can possibly imagine. I was a young, starry-eyed 21-year-old, 6 months out of drama college. I had just finished doing two shows up at the Royal Theatre in Northampton. I did a show called They're Playing Our Song by Marvin Hamlisch, and then I played one of the baddies' henchmen in Aladdin. It was one of the comedy Chinese policemen. And finished that show and then went straight into Miss Saigon 2 days later. I finished on the Saturday and started rehearsals on the following Monday. So it was a bit of a whirlwind, and Miss Saigon had always been one of my favourite shows. It still ranks up there. I think the music is sublime, the story is so powerful, and the music helps that, of course. So for me that was truly, truly exciting. I then went into another show by the same writers, the same guys who wrote Les Mis, Claude-Michel Schoenberg and Alain Boublil. And that was called Martin Guerre, which was not quite as successful, didn't run as long, but I still had an amazing time working on the show. And I've been in the original cast of Mary Poppins and Spamalot in the West End, as well as the Rocky Horror Show. I toured Europe playing Frankenfurter in the Rocky Horror Show, which is possibly the most fun it's possible to have on stage. You get to just be utterly foul to people and call back to the audience and interact with people. Yeah, another form of engagement, you see. This is not just a recent thing for me. And I did a show in the West End called Hedwig and the Angry Inch, where I played an East German transsexual rock chick. It was a one-woman show, and I got to strut around wearing fantastic makeup and huge long blonde wig in a variety of costumes for 90 minutes, singing an array of fantastic rock and punk songs. Really, really fantastic show. So it's running on Broadway again now, 10 years, 14 years after I did it in London. So I'm looking forward to hopefully getting the chance to go over and see it at some point over there and bring back some fabulous memories. So that's me as a performer. I've always sung in concerts and cabarets. I was in school choirs and church choirs, even though I'm not a churchgoer at all. It was just an outlet where I was able to sing when I was a child. I couldn't get enough in local amateur dramatics. I'm a proud life member of the Royal Air Force Theatrical Association. I don't get the time these days to be as active with them as I would like, but every now and then I try to pop in and help out as much as I can. And that's really who I am as a person. I think I mentioned last time, I'm 40. My birthday is in June, and I grew up in the West Country and then Oxfordshire, where I went to school. So most of my formative years were there. So well, that's enough, really, isn't it? That's enough about me. That's enough about this boy. There'll be more coming up, I'm sure. One of the things that really struck me in the responses to last week or last time's episode was just how giving people are of their time. And it, you know, it, you might say it just takes a couple of minutes to sit down and jot down a message to somebody, but actually it takes thought and it takes care and it takes the will to want to reach out. And I really appreciate that, and thank you all if you've taken the time to ask a question, make a comment. So many people were giving such wonderful feedback. It really was just really overwhelming. My husband has a pet hatred when people say, "I was really humbled." And actually, they don't mean they were humbled at all. They meant they were honoured, and being honoured is sort of elevated. Humbled is to feel small, and it's so I think people use it wrongly now. I was not humbled. I was honoured and thrilled to receive so many positive comments. So thank you very much for that. A couple of people had questions, and I did say to them that I wouldn't respond online. I wanted to wait till now. I was talking about, if you remember, for those of you who watched the first episode, my very first finished object as a knitter when I was an 8-year-old boy, which was a dark green pink panther. He's not going to make an appearance this time. A lot of people have said how charming and how delightful they thought he was. And Paulie Knits on Instagram, who I believe is Paulie81 on Ravelry, asked me if I would knit another one. Well, that's a really interesting question, and the answer is flat out no, for several reasons. I think the main reason is because for all his flaws, I love the original so much, I would never ever want to replace him. To be honest, I'm not sure I could do a better job these days. And the other reason is, so far, and I'm not going to rule anything out, but toys are not my thing. I don't have an urge to knit toys. He's the only toy I ever knitted. I didn't know what I was doing at the time, I was so young. But I really don't think it's where I am with knitting at the moment. I tend to only knit things that I want for myself, and I think the time for me and cuddly toys is probably past. I am nearly 41. Gift knitting, of course, brilliant, but I don't know, not for me. So Paulie, no, I won't be knitting another one. He's perfect as he is in my book. One of the other questions that was asked of me was, are the things on my sofa, which you can see here, hand knitted? And this question came from Amphibia Knitter, who is Jennifer. She asked whether they are hand knitted, and they are. I should probably fess up here. I've set this up for the filming. This is not what my house normally looks like. This sofa is not in front of the fireplace normally. It's usually over by the window over here, and you just have a direct view straight to the fireplace. But none of the... We've got three sofas in this room, which is quite a large room. There's one over there, there's one over there, and there's one over, usually, by the window. It's the one I'm sitting on now. And they all face into the centre of the room. I set up the camera in front of all three, and just saw blank wall behind. I was like, no, I mean, the wall behind me is a dark brown, but the other walls are more like the colour, you can see, of this wall here in the alcove, and sometimes paler. So it's just a very, very plain, really dull background. And I just didn't want that to be the backdrop for my podcasts. So I moved things around a bit. And although these cushions genuinely always live on this sofa, that's genuinely true, I did bring out this specially. It was in a cupboard. But it has been out ever since, so it now is a permanent feature here. And yes, I did knit them. I'm very proud of them both. The blanket here, which you can see is black and this sort of olive green, is not one of my own patterns. It's a pattern called Brick Street by Stephen West. It's knit in really, really fat, chunky yarn on, I think they were, may even have been 10mm needles, I forget. Really, really big stuff. It was very, very heavy by the end of it. You knit the green centre section backwards and forwards, and then when you're done, you work the border, the black border, garter stitch border, all the way around the outside. And it's really fun. It's got this lovely texture pattern here, just done with increases and decreases. It's quite straightforward, it's quite simple. It took me a little while to get into reading the knitting. I wasn't used to doing, excuse me, that kind of knitting at all. And I wasn't really used to following other people's patterns either. I'm still not, to be honest. I'm a terrible pattern follower. I only hope that the patterns that I write and put out are intelligible to other people. They make perfect sense to me, but they're probably not formatted in the way that most people's are, because I just don't really knit other stuff. I have spent so much time knitting my own things. So this was a one-off, I really enjoyed knitting it, but it took me a while, and it sort of lay in a bag for about a year, and then I had a push and finished it off. These cushion covers, now these are one of my own designs, and I'm sneakily rather pleased with them. They've not been a big seller, I'm not going to lie. They're very specifically niche English, so perhaps international watchers of this podcast may not find a reason to want to knit them. And I say they're English because what they are is two halves of the Union Jack flag, one half on each cushion. Can you see there? So that when you put the two together, you get the whole Union Jack flag. Very patriotic. I designed them in 2012, which was the year we hosted the Olympics in London, and the year of the Queen's Silver Jubilee as well. So it felt kind of patriotic to be doing British-inspired stuff. They're knitted with a yarn, I believe it's called... It's from Studio Donegal. I think it's just called Donegal Tweed. And it's this lovely... It's grey, but it's got this lovely tweed aspects of browns and yellows and blacks and white shot through it. It's really, really nice. Very, very soft. Some tweed yarns can tend to be a little bit scratchy, but this is actually really, really soft. Very, very nice to work with. She got the flag upside down. Terrible. Terrible. There we go. It's that way around. And on the back, they're knitted entirely in the round. On the back, it's just a plain rib pattern here with some lovely wooden buttons that I picked up in a local button shop. It's very interesting construction. I was quite pleased with this. It started at the bottom with a Judy Becker's Magic Cast On, quite a large one, and then immediately worked in the round with working the pattern stitches, all done with texture. There's cables in there, there's seed stitch, there's stocking stitch and reverse stocking stitch, just to create the different textures to denote the different colours of the flag. It's all one colour, clearly. And you work all the way around until you get up to where you want the opening to be for the envelope hole here. And then, sort of forget how I did it then. I worked, do you know what? For the life of me, I can't remember, but it's all in the pattern. I should have thought that one through a little bit better than I did. I wasn't planning to talk about it in such detail, and it's 3 years since I knitted them. I can't remember what I did. The pattern is called Reunion Cushion Covers, and it's called Reunion because it's the Union Jack and Reunion. Very clever. My husband's idea, he came up with that one. He's sometimes very, very witty. And there. So that's what I've got on my sofa. One of the other questions that was asked, and this was somebody incredibly eagle-eyed from the last podcast. Actually, I think I may have... I misappropriated the last question. That was not Amphibia Knitter. That was not Jennifer asking about these lovely things. It was AJ in Quebec. Sorry, AJ, who is the Jasper Patch on Ravelry. I've just seen here on my notes. That question, that was to you, AJ, and I hope you enjoyed hearing the answer. Amphibia Knitter, who is Jennifer, and that is true, her question was about being very eagle-eyed, and she asked why we have a tuning fork on the mantelpiece, which I'm hopefully pointing at now. That's because it's a very musical household, quite simply. It's a house lived in by a musical theatre performer and my husband, who is a composer. He's a very, very fine composer, and I urge anyone, his name is Benjamin Till, if you're unaware of his work, head to iTunes and look up The London Requiem by Benjamin Till. It's a brilliant, brilliant orchestral and choral piece. It's about 50 minutes to an hour long, and it's a true requiem, but it's called The London Requiem because Ben always likes to work with documentary aspects in his music and elements of real life being woven throughout what he writes. And in the case of The London Requiem, he went to have quite a major road just outside my window. In fact, it's the A1, it leads from London to Edinburgh, and I'm at the start of it. And sometimes people get a little bit impatient. Shh, I'm recording. In the case of The London Requiem, the documentary aspect is Ben spent months going around a lot of London cemeteries collecting poignant, beautiful, witty, funny inscriptions from gravestones and wove them into the standard Latin Requiem text and created something incredibly beautiful. So your ear hears the mush of the Latin that most people don't understand, and as pinpricks of light all the way through it, you hear these wonderful, poignant phrases, my favourite of which belongs to the grave of a woman simply known as Yassi. She died about 10 years ago and is buried in London. We subsequently found out through contacting her family that she died from breast cancer. She was only 40 years old. But her inscription just made me fall in love with her. It just said in speech marks, "And we laughed and laughed and laughed." That became one of the anthemic themes in Ben's Requiem, sung by the Rebel Chorus, which is a choir that he and I put together of friends of ours, who are all brilliant singers and come from different vocal walks of life. We've got opera singers and folk singers and musical theatre singers and church singers, all gospel singers, all kinds of different voice types that blend together really, really nicely, even though it sounds like they probably wouldn't. So check out The London Requiem on iTunes. It is beautiful. It's big, epic, powerful stuff, and I think you'll really enjoy it. So that's why we have a tuning fork. It was a gift from Ben's friend Fiona, who is a very keen violinist, a very fantastic violinist, in fact, and she is off on tour at the moment with Placebo. She does the string arrangements for their band, for their albums. So that was one half of Amphibia Knitter's question. The other was, why do you have this tuning fork, and what is the deliciously creepy skull next to it? Now, you may have noticed that the deliciously creepy skull is not anymore on my mantelpiece. That's because it's here. It's not a skull at all. It's actually it's a Grayson Award. Now, this is a Grayson Award for those of you who don't know, and there's no reason why you would. John Grayson was a sort of pioneering documentary filmmaker, and the Graysons are probably the most prestigious documentary awards that the world has to offer, certainly that the UK has to offer. And in November, Ben and I were incredibly proud to win this Grayson Award in the category of Best Entertaining Documentary 2014. So what did we do in order to win a documentary? Well, this comes back to this podcast being about me and my personal story. As you know, I'm a gay man with a husband, and Ben and I got married last year on March the 29th, which was the first day that same-sex marriage became legal in England and Wales. It's a long, hard struggle, and we'd both been vociferous campaigners for marriage equality rights. And because of who we are and what we do, we decided we wanted to make a bit of a song and dance about getting married, quite literally, and we wrote a film where we staged our entire wedding ceremony as a musical. And it was quite honestly the most extraordinary thing I've ever done. It was definitely the most stressful thing I've ever done. We had 7.5 weeks from the day the film got commissioned to the day we got married to write, between us, to write 46 minutes worth of music for an hour-long television show. And organise a wedding from scratch. A lot of people get 12 to 18 months advance warning of organising a wedding, we had to do it in 7.5 weeks. It was frenetic and mad, and it was a film that we made with a production company called Wingspan Productions, and was broadcast on Channel 4 2 days later.
I call upon these persons here present to witness that I, Nathan John Gaich, do take thee, David Benjamin Till, to be my lawful wedded husband. Benji, I stand before you today, on this incredible day, when love is finally free, and we can finally be as one. And that's what we are, and that's what we've always been. And I want to grow old with you, two grumpy old men, holding hands in the rain, with two whole lifetimes of memories between us to share. What could be better? You make me better, simple as that. And who else would put up with me? And who else would put up with you? And I'm so glad we found each other. It's you and me against the world. And if it's true that the winner takes it all, I won the biggest prize when you gave me your love. So I want to thank you for letting me love you and for being my friend. Benjamin, I love you. I love you.
We wanted to tell a much broader story than just, look, two men getting married, isn't it wonderful? We told the story of the struggle for equality in England and Wales over the last 50 years or so. It's less than 50 years since it was illegal to be gay in this country. I'm a child of Clause 28, which for people outside the UK was a law brought in by Margaret Thatcher in the early 1980s to prevent teachers from being able to talk about homosexuality in a positive light in schools. And that had a very damaging effect on a whole generation of gay men and women, young gay men and women, growing up feeling and believing that they were somehow wrong and disgusting. And so we moved through the story to civil partnership, which is an amazing thing. It's not a route that Ben and I ever went down, although we've been together for over 12 years now. But when it came round to full equality and actual marriage, we thought it was time to do something about it in a big way. Well, the film went down incredibly well. We received a lot of attention at the time, in the press, online, on the television. We took part in numerous TV debates. We were on Channel 4 News talking about the pros and cons of same-sex marriage with people who were against it. Suddenly it felt like we were becoming the poster boys for gay marriage in the UK, and that was kind of difficult. We didn't expect that. We didn't know quite what to expect when we put ourselves into this sort of circus. And we knew that there would be some opposition, and we knew that perhaps the gay community wouldn't approve of what we were doing either, sort of reinforcing stereotypes of gay men in musicals. But we confronted all of those issues in the film, and we're incredibly proud of it. Everything that could legally be sung was sung. The registrar sang. Amazing woman called Francine Allen. She's a real registrar. One of the people working on the production team found her, and we went and met with her And she was willing to sing. She's wonderful in the film. Ben and I sang our vows to each other. And that was the only part of the film that we wrote in secret from each other. We had never heard a single note or a single word of our vows until we were singing them to each other on camera in our actual wedding ceremony. The pressure was up here through the roof, through the top of the screen there. We also featured a duet in the film from our mums, singing about a time 25 years ago where they discovered that their sons were gay, living in a different time then and how that affected them. And it was really brave of them to confront those things and deal with parts of their lives that they're perhaps not so proud of now, but they did it brilliantly, and that's the one part of the film that most people say touched them the most. We've just had, 3 weeks ago, the film was shown on Australian television, so this sort of living in another round of going through wedding stuff. So here we are, this is John Grierson. I think he looks a bit like a grumpy Stephen Sondheim, which I don't mind at all. And if you can see on camera there, it's for Our Gay Wedding, the musical, Grierson 2014. Incredibly proud. In fact, tonight, this very night, after I finish recording this, Ben and I have been invited to another award ceremony, again for the wedding film. This is for a Royal Television Society award, where we are, I think, up for Best Arts Documentary. And we're up against Grayson Perry and his fantastic season, Who Are You?, which we loved watching, and I suspect he's going to win it. Although apparently he won it last year. Anyway, by the time you get to watch this, I'll know the answer, so I'll put it underneath. So that's who my deliciously creepy skull is, and that's a little bit about who I am. Actually, you can still watch the wedding film, I should have said. You can still watch it in the UK on 4OD, which is Channel 4's catch-up service. It's called Our Gay Wedding, the Musical, and you can find it there. You can also download it from iTunes. I think it costs £1.89. Not that I'm trying to flog it, if you are interested and can't see it any other way. I have heard recently that somebody in the States did find it somewhere online. I don't have a link for you, but if you're outside the UK and you want to watch it, I think it does exist somewhere. Welcome to my wedding. I hope you enjoy it. So that's that. I'd like to talk more about the community as a whole, really, the knitting community. Firstly, thank you so much. You know who you are. Josh Ricks, Sword of a Knitter. Immediately after I had posted this, the first episode of my podcast, he recorded his, and I'd had some dealings with him. We'd had a couple of email exchanges or message exchanges, and he then recorded his next episode. He does it weekly. He's much more diligent than I will ever be. And he basically spoke for about 5 minutes about how much he'd enjoyed my first episode. Josh, thank you so much. I know that a lot of people have found me as a result of what you've said, so brilliant. I always enjoy listening to you, and I'm so glad that we've been able to reciprocate and help each other out. So if you're watching this, Josh, and I think you will be, hello, and thank you very much. Big thanks to Elizabeth Green Musselman of Dark Matter Knits, whose podcast I adore, and the more I get to know her as a person, the more I adore her as well. Elizabeth, I adore you. We should be neighbours, we should be good friends. Let's hope that we get to meet in person one day. I'd really enjoy that. She's also been sending lots of people over with recommendations to come and watch, so thank you for that. I was looking at some of the statistics for the first podcast episode on YouTube. There's an analytics thing that you can log into and you can see who's watching where. And I was really fascinated and gratified to learn that 17% of viewers of my first episode were male, which I think is actually quite a high proportion. I would doubt that there are many as 17% of knitters who are male, so people are clearly finding me because there's the boy connection. So extending the hand of friendship, boy knitter to boy knitter, hello. And to my other 83%, hello of course as well. You're all very, very important to me. That's the truth. Many people have been saying on various platforms that me talking about double knitting, with which I am obsessed, as you will now know, has inspired them to either to go back to double knitting if it's something that they've done in the past and not continued with, or to take it up firsthand for the first time. And that is so amazing for me, so wonderfully gratifying, because I'm totally evangelical about sharing double knitting with people, and I'm always telling people that that it's not beyond them. A lot of people, I think, are frightened by it and think it's beyond their capabilities. It's really not. I think double knitting is so much more forgiving than stranded colour work, Fair Isle stuff. I think I may have said this in the last one. It doesn't cause so many problems with tension or puckering or anything like that. It kind of just gets on with it and does it. As long as you get used to the mechanics of where you're putting the yarns and which yarn you use for each stitch, you're golden. Honestly, it's not as hard as you think. And I've been saying this to so many people online over the last couple of weeks that I seem to have evolved my own little catchphrase. I never intended for it to be so, but my catchphrase has become OSAT, which is OSAAT, and it stands very simply for one stitch at a time. And I think that's a really good metaphor, not just for double knitting. No matter how complicated your knitting is, it may be the most complicated lace shawl, and Josh, your Evenstar shawl is beautiful and incredibly complicated. It's a matter of if it's that, or whether it's double knitting, or anything at all, the largest project, the smallest project, doesn't make any difference. It's only ever going to be one stitch at a time. And I think that's a really good metaphor for life as well. No matter how complicated things are, just take it one stitch at a time. So that's my personal mantra now, hashtag OSAT. So you'll probably hear me talk about that many, many times, the more you get to know me. I genuinely believe it as well. I'm not just saying it. Double knitting is no more complicated than anything else because it is only one stitch at a time. OSAT, you have been told. I've also tried to make sure that my Ravelry group is much more active and a much more social place than I've ever had it be before. And that seems to be working. I've started a couple of threads on there, some relating to this podcast. One particularly was for the first episode. Other threads for things, questions that I asked in the podcast, like what's your first knitting project and things like that. If you have any questions that you want to ask me, that you want me to answer on the podcast about me or my knitting, then head over to my group. It's the Sockmatician on Ravelry, and there's a thread there for questions as well. But one of the things that's become the most active, and I'm really, really pleased I started it, is problems with double knitting. I'm not going to pretend to be the world's best expert in the field at all, but it is something that I'm passionate about, and I do know a bit about it. And as I say, I'm really keen to share what I know with other people. So if you're struggling with double knitting, or you're thinking about picking it up but you want to ask questions, there's a thread there specially for you. Problems with double knitting, I think I called it, or problems with DK. It's bound to be one that's near the top, because a lot of people are asking questions and posting photographs of things that are not going so well for them, which is really, really helpful. So if you've got any problems like that and you want me to sort of have a look and see if I can help you, then head over there and I'll do what I can. I can't promise that I'll be able to fix your problems by remote control, but you know, I'll do my best to try and point out where you might want to do things slightly differently to help yourself. The other thing that that came to light yesterday, it's something I was thinking about, my friend Tina, who is Wicked Woolly Witch on Ravelry, hello Tina, she actually set my group up for me. She was the person who said I needed to be present on Ravelry as a designer when I first started a few years ago. So she's one of the moderators of the group as well. She and I both moderated together. She was saying that I should put up a separate page on my group with like an FAQs, double knitting FAQs, and I think it's a brilliant idea, absolutely brilliant idea. So I'm going to get on with that over the next few weeks. So if you have any problems with double knitting, I may already be in the process of answering your problems there. By all means, ask the questions now. But once that page goes up, check there first. And I may already have answered or given some help that may help you, so you can get it immediately. So I think that's going to be a really exciting part of the future of my group, and I'm really looking forward to seeing how that progresses. So what else have I been doing? This last week I have filmed, edited and uploaded here to YouTube on my channel three new videos. If you're already subscribing, you've probably seen them already, or you've certainly been notified about them, I would imagine. The three new double knitting tutorials, they're about 5 minutes long each, for three different techniques. One is for a simple bind off, a very easy bind off. It's for double knitting. It's very similar to a standard knitted bind off where you pull one stitch over the other. You'd be very familiar with that, but some people I think get a bit scared when they have twice as many stitches on their needle and just think, I don't know how to do this. And of course some of them will be knit and some of them will be purl, but all that information is there. That's called a simple bind off for double knitting. The other two videos, one was for a make one increase in double knitting, and I show you how to do make one left, that's my left, and make one right, that's my right. Because of course when you're working in double knitting you have two faces of the fabric to deal with. You have the side that is facing you and the side that is away from you, and you need to make an increase on both sides, and that can sometimes be quite confusing for people because you're working the increase as a purl increase for the other side. Sounds quite complicated, it's actually not, and I do that in a tutorial for you, so that's there for you. And the other one escapes me for the moment. I did a third as well. It's there, it's all there on my channel, you'll find it. So this is all in an effort to sort of balance the fact that I have been feeling quite guilty. Now, I don't want to use this podcast as an opportunity for self-therapy. That's not what I'm here for at all. But I have been feeling quite guilty about certain things. I hold my hand up, there it is. I hold my hand up and say, the reason I am present online is because I'm trying to create a niche for myself as a designer, and I'm selling patterns, and I make no apologies for that. I want to earn a bit of money out of the work that I've put into it. And that's partly why I've wanted to do this podcast as well, is to be able to spread the word and share what I'm doing to a wider audience. So I don't want anyone to think that this is all take from me. So for me it's really important that I'm also giving something back. And that's why I do the tutorials. I want to make sure that the tutorials are there for techniques that I use in my patterns that people might be unfamiliar with, to give them help. But those are people who've paid me money, so of course they deserve my help. But I very specifically decided to just make those videos public, so that anybody can find them useful, I hope. And I want to be able to share as much as I can of what I know with people who don't know it yet, and that's something that I'm really passionate about. So that's kind of why I'm doing that, and why I'm doing this as well. Yes, of course it's all there to raise awareness of me as a designer and of my brand, but I do want to help. So as I say, pop over to the Ravelry group and post your questions there, and I will do my very best for you. If you have any ideas for things that you would like to see in a video tutorial, then please do get in touch. I don't plan to become a comprehensive encyclopedia of tutorials for all kinds of knitting skills. I'm mostly going to focus on double knitting because that's where I think there are fewer video tutorials out there to be had. If anyone wants to learn how to do an SSK, there's thousands of tutorials out there that will do it, so I don't feel the need to duplicate that in any way. But if there's something a bit more unusual that you can't find a tutorial for, and you would like to know how it's done, then let me know and I'll look into it for you. There will be more coming up in the future as well. What else have I got? Really, really excitingly, on the sort of helping and teaching front, I've been asked by Dame Hilary Bloom, who was one of the co-founders of Knit for Peace, which is an organisation who encouraged knitters who might not have family members that they want to knit for, who still want to knit, to link them up with people in foreign countries who need the clothes, usually in sort of war-torn countries where people are struggling through war and dispute. They provide ways and they distribute clothes that knitters knit for them to people who need them. I think it's a wonderful organisation. And I've been asked through a mutual friend by Dame Hillary, who set up the organisation, if I would like to teach a double knitting class, seminar, session, call it what you will, at the University Women's Club in Mayfair. As part of a Knit for Peace weekend, fundraiser weekend that they're doing. I'm incredibly excited about it. It will be my second double knitting tutorial, second of many more, I hope. Fingers crossed, many more. And I'm really looking forward to it. I don't know many of the details about it yet, how many people are likely to be there, what kind of level they'll be at. I really don't know. So it'll be a bit of a leap of faith, but I'll be doing that in April, and I'm really looking forward to it. So thank you, Dame Hillary. I'm sure you're not watching. Thank you anyway for asking me along. I'm delighted to be part of it. So, on to some knitting stuff now. Before we get on to some knitting stuff, I'm not even going to edit that out, I don't care. Before we get on to some knitting things, one of the questions I asked in the last episode was, going on from my dark green string vest Pink Panther, what was your first project, your first finished object? And several people have been in touch and shared some really, really lovely stories. There's Nancy Knott, I think that's her name, Nancy Knott, I can't remember, it might be Nancy Knit, I think it's Nancy Knott, told me a wonderful story about her scarf. I'm going to open up my iPad because I've got some details on it. About her scarf that she knitted when she was very, very young, and I'd love to quote a little bit from what she wrote here. The standard scarf, a piece of knitting that has long since hit the tip. I was 9, and the sides became very narrow, and then very, very wide. It was a normal, horrific scarf. My granny used to laugh as I knit more and more complicated things as the years went by. She always grinned and said, "Remember when you knit that scarf? Remember the edges, and now look what you knit." I absolutely love that story. I love the idea that her granny saw the progression of that 9-year-old becoming a competent knitter, knitting wonderful things, but seeing the humble beginnings and how that progressed to wonderful things as well. I really, really love that story. Kerry Wallace as well, hello Kerry. She contacted me and showed me some pictures of some amigurumi that she... Amigurumi, I don't know. Toys. It's not something I know about. But these guys are really cute. I'm going to show you a picture. She crocheted these. Edgar and his little friend Swampy. Here they are. They're incredibly cute. I love the mismatched button eyes on the larger one. I think they're really, really fun. So that was really, really lovely. I have another beautiful story that came from Candy Pickletoes, whose name is... I wrote it down here somewhere. Candy Pickletoes. Oh, Barbara. Hello, Barbara in Maryland. Hi. Your story really touched my heart. I hope you don't mind me quoting it. Do you know what? I'm going to assume, if you contact me, that you're okay with me quoting things on the podcast and saying hello. If you would prefer me not to, please say, and I will of course respect that. But some of the things that people are sharing are so lovely that I just want to share them with you guys as well. So I hope you don't mind. So Barbara said, I don't have a picture because my first FO was when I was 13 years old in the 80s. It was horrible. It was a 1980s acrylic red, purple, blue, orange blanket that I forced my mother to put on her bed. I believe now that it probably gave her nightmares every night, but she, like a good mother, kept it on her bed until it fell apart. Such a sweet soul for putting up with it. Oh, I almost want to cry reading that story. I think it's absolutely beautiful. I really, really love it. And then there was one more that I want to share with you. Now, this story comes from Elvin's Knits, who is Sharon in California. Hello, Sharon. Again, I hope you don't mind me sharing. I think this reads like a piece of poetry. It's so beautifully worded. She says, I've been knitting for 50 plus years. I can't believe that from her photograph. She doesn't look anywhere near that old. I can't believe looking at it that you've been alive for 50 years, let alone knitting that long. My very first piece I knitted was my own doll blanket. I was 9 years old, clearly the time for it. Sadly, I do not have it, but if I close my eyes, I can still see it. It was all garter stitch, and I would guess about 14 inches square. I used purple, blue, and rose-coloured yarn and made 3 huge stripes. It had numerous holes in it from the drop stitches, but I loved it so much. My grandmother lived with us, so she taught me many things as I grew up. My life has been filled with every kind of needlework I could learn, along with painting, drawing, ceramics, sewing, etc. I don't have everything I made. I love giving things to my family and friends as gifts. My whole life I have wanted nothing more than to create. Giving someone the perfect gift in itself is a gift to me. I get so much joy watching their face as they open it. I'm sure many people share that sentiment, Sharon. I'm retired now and live with my daughter and her family, so I spend every moment I can creating whatever my heart desires. My daughter spoils me to pieces. Oh, Sharon, you sound like the most wonderful person. Your daughter sounds amazing. And what a wonderful way to live life. I'm very, very envious. I hope that I too have a time in my life when I can just give things to people. What a lovely lady you are. So those are the stories that people have been sharing with me. If you've got any more, please feel free. I love hearing about them. They really make my heart go warm and cozy when I hear the joy that knitting gives to people. It's really a very special thing, don't you think? So on to me. Back to me, everybody, back to me. It's all about me. Do you know what an actor's favourite warm-up exercise is? Me, 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 more about me. Here we go. It's an old actor's joke. Actually, it's a stage manager's joke told about actors. There's always friction between stage managers and actors. You, hopefully, always in jest, but I'm not so sure sometimes. What have I been working on? Well, whips time. I am still working on pretty much the same items that I was working on last time. Double knit scarves take time to knit, and unfortunately two of them, the two based on the mathematical fractals, are very much secret, and I'm not going to be able to show them to you. One of them is about this long now, about that long and probably about that wide, so it's a fairly substantial piece. And that's made with fingering weight yarn, so it's growing pretty slowly. That's mostly my home knitting, so that's my telly knitting at night. I don't tend to knit with that out and about, because the pattern's a little bit complicated. I need to keep my head in the game for that. So it's okay when I'm at home with fewer distractions. The other one, the simpler version of the same pattern, is the DK weight scarf. That's now getting quite long, maybe 3.5 feet long so far. It's much narrower, it has fewer stitches in it, and it grows much more quickly, and the pattern is much less complex. So that's one that I knit on the tube. I was knitting on the tube the other day, yesterday in fact, on my way home from work, and you'd have thought knitting was something that no one had ever seen or heard of before. I swear every single person in the carriage was staring at me. And part of me wants to sort of embrace that, and part of me wants people just to either say hello and be upfront about it. What I don't like is the surreptitious sort of murmurings behind the hands. I don't like that so much. It's always positive stuff. I think most people think it's pretty cool to see a guy knitting. I have a big leather motorbike jacket. I used to ride a motorbike, and it's sort of faded and a bit scratched from a couple of times when I came off the bike. I've got this big beard, and I'm quite a tall man. I'm just 6 feet tall, and so I think people are quite surprised to see someone of my physical build and type knitting, because of course there are still so many associations with knitting. I think women get it all the time. People get told that it's a granny thing, or it's just for old ladies, which is of course a nonsense, but men get told that it's just for women, and I think those things still come to play, and so people find me a bit of an oddity when I knit out and about. But I do, and I won't stop. I'm always aware that people are staring, but that's okay. Spread the word. So those two things are still undergo, and I can't show them to you, I'm afraid. I will when they're done, I promise. But the sock, which is rapidly in my head being called the guilt sock. I showed it to you last time, and I'd only just gone past the cuff. Now, I promise I have done some. I really, really have. I'm just trying to untangle it here. It's been in the bag a few days. I did some in the car on the way to Ben's parents on Sunday. We went up there for Mother's Day. And it really is bigger, I promise, although you might not be able to tell. Here it is. It's pathetic, isn't it? The progress of maybe a centimetre and a half. But I'll get a little bit closer so you can see. Here is the sock pattern. And it does have this lovely, lovely texture. I'm enjoying how it looks. It is a bit dull to knit, not gonna lie. So that's why it's not growing very quickly. It's in a fiber spates yarn, Sheila's sock, I think it was called, and the colourway is Rainforest. It's been in stash for a long time. Couldn't tell you where I bought it. No idea. I think it may have been from a... I don't know. It might have been from a show, or it may have been a shop. I don't know. But yeah, there it is. It's kind of fun. I keep showing it. There will be more progress next time. Hopefully something more substantial. That's keeping me keeping my guilt levels up. And if I show it to people, then I definitely will be needing to knit something more on it. And the other thing I'm knitting, well, back to Josh Ricks. This is one of his designs. It's a fantastic shawl called Greek Fire. There's quite a story behind this. Just before Christmas, my friend Sam, who's the man who taught me how to knit socks in the first place, he and I decided... I came across Josh's pattern called Greek Fire. It's beautiful. It's got stripes and short row shaping. Excuse me, I've got a very itchy nose and it's not going to stop. It's going to make me sneeze. Really, really lovely. Three colours. Some stocking stitch, some garter stitch, some... panels of mosaic slip stitch colour work going on, all really, really lovely, lots of things crammed into one shawl, but it's still really, really balanced, asymmetric, really good. And I loved it, and Sam loved it as well. So when we got together for our monthly craft and cake meeting, which we do at his house with our friend Julie, who also lives there, and various other friends, we eat cake and we craft. Doesn't have to be knitting, but it has to be craft, and we do that once a month. And at Christmas, Sam and I decided that we were going to cast on the Greek Fire. So we both bought our copies. We wouldn't have shared it, Josh, I promise. We both bought copies. And we both cast on. Now, Sam hasn't had any chance to continue with his. Unfortunately, he's busy doing other things at the moment, so that's had to take a bit of a back seat for him. But I was really enjoying it, and I was getting some decent knitting time on it. And I finished! I finished Greek Fire, and I was really, really pleased with it. And Josh, I know you've seen it because you commented on the Instagram photograph, so many of you from Instagram will have already seen the finished object. It's lovely. I really, really liked it. And my husband, who is very, very sensitive to natural fibres, was able to wear it. This was one of the few things. It was knitted with Cascade 440 fingering weight yarn. Very pure wool, but very, very soft. And he... was okay with it. Usually he's like, oh, get it away from me, I can't touch wool, certainly can't have it around his neck, can barely touch it with his hands. But for some reason this was soft enough, maybe it's the garter stitch, the bounce in there, I don't know. So I gave it to him, and I was really pleased that he was able to wear a garter stitch, a knitted shawl. And he took it away that weekend. He went away for a couple of days, and when he came back, he didn't have it. Was on a train somewhere. He gets hot, he takes things off, he puts them beside him and forgets. This is not the first time this has happened. I knitted him a hat, my Wuppertal design. He's the model in the pictures. He modelled it. I gave it to him after he'd modelled it, and we took in the pictures, and we went straight into town to do something else. We got on the tube. And as we got off the tube, I looked at him and went, Ben, where's your hat? He went, it's on the seat, just as the doors closed and the tube pulled away. Two strikes, mate. Two strikes and a third one, and you are out. I will knit for you again. I will. If you lose it, that's it. So I'm hoping he's not actually watching this. I'm hoping he doesn't see this, because he doesn't know. I had enough wool left over of all three colours from the original Greek fire to start making him another one. So this is, he's not in the house now, which is why I can show you, but I'm only knitting it when I'm out. I knit it when I'm at work, if I get some downtime in lunch breaks and things. My phone clearly has a very small capacity for capturing video, and it's going to stop there, I think, every time we do this. Where was I? I was talking about Greek Fire by Josh Ricks. Here it is. Here's how I'm getting on with it so far. Isn't it wonderful? Isn't it amazing? Look at the stripes we've got in my mouth again, like last time. We've got these lovely shorter stripes here, and we've got here as well, and they're completely asymmetrical, but really well balanced, really well done. There's lovely bits of mosaic knitting here, the slip stitch feature, and different textures with the garter stitch. It's really, really nicely done. So, as I say, Ben doesn't know that I'm knitting this, and I will be looking forward to giving it to him, and I'll get so many brownie points for it. Can I make a little confession? Josh, I hope you don't mind. I've made a tiny modification to the structure of it. Not structure, just how I'm doing it. I have recently discovered something amazing, possibly the most innovative thing to me that I could possibly hope to find in knitting. This is the German short row. Are you aware of German short rows at all? They are, oh my goodness, they are amazing. They completely, for me, negate the need to do a wrap and turn. I may never do a wrap and turn again as long as I live. German short rows are so easy to do. They don't interrupt the flow of your knitting at all. And they're invisible. They're completely invisible. The first time I knitted Greek Fire, every time, I'm sure this is more to do with my execution of the technique rather than the technique itself. I don't have much experience of doing wrap and turn stuff. But every time I did the wrap and turn, I was left with a little hole. Now, this didn't bother me too much because it's a well-run pattern and the holes are nicely evenly spaced, so it looked like a little design feature. It was fine. And it was only very small, but it did bug me a little bit. With the German short rows, no holes. It's invisible. Let me show you. So, this is the area where the short rows happen. And it's just, I mean, yes, you can see through the knitting, there are clearly holes, but there's no holes that are any bigger than any of the others. It's just invisible. It just flows. It's amazing. So I'm never going to do a wrap and turn again. And I think, I don't think there's a use for a wrap and turn where you can't substitute a German short row in. It's brilliant. Brilliant. There's no picking up of wraps to worry about. There's no actual wrapping to do. There's none of that dreadful slipping backwards and forwards that you need to do. Amazing. So Josh, I hope you don't mind, but I've done them all the way along those two sections of short rows there, and great effect. So there I am. That's my whips at the moment. I toyed with the idea of telling Ben that I'd gone to the trouble of locating and finding his original Greek Fire, but actually, I'm going to let him know how much extra work I've done for him, just because I love him, and because I want the brownie points. What's coming up for me in terms of knitting? Well, I don't often plan ahead to do things that I'm not sort of formulating a design for, but I mentioned that I was at Ben's parents, and his mum is a knitter, Noelle, my mother-in-law. She's a knitter, and she's a very instinctive knitter. She's brilliant. She doesn't often follow patterns at all. She just does stuff, just makes it happen. She was knitting a jumper that she just wasn't enjoying. She'd stopped loving it. And between the two of us, we unworked. We ripped out quite a lot of work that she'd put on it because she wanted to reclaim the yarn. It's quite nice, actually. She's given me all of the yarn. She sort of, as I say, she fell out of love with it. Some of it is in the balls that we balled up. It's this lovely sort of dusky plum colour. It's an alpaca yarn. Try and get one out. She said it was dirt cheap. She got it from Amazon, I think. I don't know the brand. AP. Albin promotion. Are you familiar with this? It's very soft. It's a DK weight. It's 100% alpaca. It's really nice. I'm a big fan of alpaca. I love the drape. So she gave it to me, thinking I would want to do something with it. But of course, it's such a generous gift. I'm going to make something for her. So I've found a cardigan pattern, which I've already approved by her. So she likes it already. And I'm going to show it to you now. It's unimaginatively called the Rib and Lace Cardigan by Deborah Newton. I think it was in Vogue Knitting. And here it is. It's got this lovely lacy front and the ribbed top. Nice big sort of bold diamond lace pattern there. And I think Noelle, my mother-in-law, will look rather fetching in it. So that's what's going to happen there. That's certainly the plan for that anyway. That's what's coming up. In terms of finished objects, I haven't really finished anything since I last saw you, but there was an object that I finished just before I recorded the last one, so I think that kind of counts. I am, of course, Sockmatician. I do knit a lot of socks, and I decided I wanted to do my first ever toe-ups. I've only ever knitted cuff down, that's how I was taught, and I love the fit. I really enjoy the structure of knitting a gusset and heel flap. And with a standard heel turn. I love all of that. But I wanted to knit some toe-up socks just because I never had. And I'd bought some West Yorkshire Spinners DK weight Blueface Leicester from a lovely shop called Wild and Woolly in northeast London. And it's very inexpensive, and it was quite a generous yardage. And I thought, I can get a pair of socks out of this and some nice house socks. And Blueface Leicester's quite sturdy, so it wouldn't be too bad, even though it doesn't have any nylon content. And they're just plain socks, but they represent a lot of firsts. Here they are. Here they are. It's just very natural colours, undyed colours. And they're my first ever bit of toe up. So I started with a Judy Becker's Magic Cast, and I wasn't following a pattern. I just sort of muddled through. I was doing the increases for the toes, and I'm working down the foot. It's really, really soft, really lovely. I like Blueface Leicester enormously. And they do have a gusset and heel flap construction, but that's worked from this direction rather than down from the top. And unlike, I don't know if you've ever done this kind of sock, but unlike when you work from the top, you work a heel flap, you stop working the round and you go backwards and forwards. Well, with these, I never stopped working in the round. I did all of the increases, getting larger as the gusset formed, and then continued knitting round as... I'm not entirely sure how it happened, but it just sort of did. They're really warm, they're really cosy, they're really comfortable. I did my first ever Jenny's Surprisingly Stretchy bind off, my first ever this way up heel flap, this way. Oh, I did some German short rows for turning the heel as well. Now I'm such a convert. It's felted a little bit because I've worn them a few times already. And it shaped the heel really nicely with completely invisible short row stuff. German short rows are the way forward. Oh my goodness. Learn them. If you haven't learned them, they will change your life. So that's my finished object for the day. I do want to sort of delve into historic FOs as a feature of this podcast. And today I thought I would show you Perplexus. Now this was my very first ever double knitted project, so it's where it all started for me. It was my first ever designed double knitted project, and it's a scarf. And it's called Perplexus. Perplexus is something which perplexes or baffles someone. And it's got a little, I found this optical illusion online and converted it into a chart for knitting. And it's only horizontal and vertical lines, but they're stacked up in such a way that you can see diamonds. Sounds odd. Let me show you. There. There are no diagonal lines anywhere in this pattern at all. But it's really weird if you move it around like that. So I made seven... Well, I didn't make seven. I made a scarf that was continuous seven squares, and with three different colours, the green, the white, and the maroon, burgundy. And here is the scarf. It's made with Artisano fingering weight alpaca. It's... Oh, I love it. I do have this thing for alpaca. At first, I thought the alpaca might be a little bit hairy and a little bit scratchy on my neck, and it sort of was, and I just loved the scarf so much, I bullied myself into not being bothered by the itch. Alpaca always feels so lovely and soft to the hands, but because of the guard hairs, it can be a little bit, on more sensitive skin, can be a bit itchy. This is not now. I've acclimatized myself to wearing it. I pretty much wear it every day. I do try to rotate with some of my other scarves so that they get worn as well, but this is my go-to scarf. It's so soft and so lovely. Of course, being double knit, that side you get a green pattern on a white background, that side you get a white pattern on a green background. Almost impossible to tell. The squares are not, contrary to popular belief, identical. This one, if you can see, the squares in the center diamond and around the outside are vertical, but in the next square along, the squares in the center diamond and in the square and the spacer outside are horizontal. So there's two different charts that alternate their way along and different color combinations, so endless possibilities. It's called Perplexus. It is available in Sockmatician's sock shop, even though it's a scarf. Didn't think that through, did I? And I love it. This is Perplexus, and I wear it very nearly every single day. I'm going to miss it when the weather warms up. So that's my historic FO. We've all got some stash, right? That's my stash enhancement, I guess, is the alpaca. I have some stash. It's not massive, not huge by any means. I think I talked about it last time. I don't want to get a huge stash, but there are some things in it that have been in it for a very long time. Deep stash. My deep stash only goes back less than 4 years, because that's when I started buying yarn, but it's still stuff that I've had for a long time. I bought quite a lot of things at the beginning when I got overexcited. Oh, pretty colours, oh, it's beautiful, I must have it. And I bought all this stuff that I didn't really know what I wanted to do with. And what I want to show you today is something from my deep stash. I still have no idea what I would do with it. It's not going to work for double knitting because it's so multicoloured. I think the colours are gorgeous. I really still do enjoy it. And here it is. It's from Colinette. It's their Jitterbug range. And it's the colourway called Mardi Gras. It is fantastic. I mean, close up. The closer you get, the more colours you see. Can you see that? There's fluorescent. There's lime green, fluorescent yellow. There's darker blues, light blues, purples, reds, oranges, darker greens. Brownie colours in there as well. I have no idea quite how long each section of colour is, so I don't know what it would look like knitted up. Some quite electric blue in there as well that I'm seeing, kingfisher blue. It's an amazing colourway, and the colours are so vivid. And it's 400 yards, it's 150 grams, so it's kind of a sport weight really. It says here needle size 3.25, so I guess it works out like a sport weight. I do love it. It's not going to be for double knitting. It's not really going to be a pair of socks, I don't think. What should it be? Answers on a postcard. No, don't put them on a postcard. Drop them into my Ravelry group. What should this fabulous skein of Mardi Gras become? I do love it. I do want to knit with it, and I'm really looking forward to seeing something with it. But I just don't know what. Any ideas? Something that these kind of colours and this sort of colourway would work really well with. It's a nice sort of tightly plied yarn, so I think it'll have good stitch definition, if that helps you making some suggestions. So, I don't know. See what you can come up with, and maybe I will knit whatever I think is the best idea. Who knows? So that's my deep stash. There's only really one more thing I want to talk about today. It's something I talked about in the last episode as well. It was my new double knit cowl called Remember, which is my tribute to all the centenary commemorations of the First World War that we are experiencing at the moment. The reason I'm talking about it again is I finally released the pattern on Ravelry. Here it is. It's called Remember because of the poppies and because of its associations with the First World War. It's double knit, so it's entirely reversible. Turn it inside out and you get the opposite colours there. It's a very asymmetrical spread of poppies that work their way all the way around. And the fun thing is a lot of the poppies have bobbles in the middle, little bobbles there on both sides. So there's some fun techniques going on there, and also in the larger poppies, I didn't want to do bubbles there, so I've done the centres here are done with reverse stocking stitch to give some more texture as well. So it's not just your straightforward double knit project, there's a bit more to it than that. You can wear it just as a cowl, you can turn it the other way, you can have it as a little collar like that. It's quite versatile, it's really comfortable. And what I've tried to do with the pattern, what I've endeavoured to do as hard as I possibly can, is to write it so that even if you've never done any double knitting before, you'll still be able to knit this. Once you've got the basics of double knitting, there's not much to it other than that. And I've got step-by-step tutorials included in the pattern, as well as technique tutorials for the bobbles and for the reverse stocking stitch, for the cast on and the cast off. I've even given alternative ideas for easier cast on and an easier cast off. So if you're new to double knitting and you don't want to do something which might be a little bit tricky to new hands at the game, then there's other types of cast on and cast off you can do which will make things much easier and won't affect the cowl in any way. It'll just look slightly different around the edges and still be very beautiful. So I've tried to do that as much as possible. I believe that everything you need to know is within the pattern or is in the video tutorials that are linked directly from the pattern. So even if you've not been a double knitter, if you're looking to try something, it's going to be, I'm not going to lie, it'll be a challenging first double knit project, but I hope all the skills are taught to you as you go along. If not, drop me a line, let me know, and put your problems in the Problems with DK thread on my Ravelry group, and I'll try and help you, but I believe you should be able to do it. It's £4.50. It will be available on Love Knitting for EU customers very soon. I suspect I'm going to stop working through Love Knitting as soon as things change on Ravelry for the EU tax laws, and keep everything in-house, so hopefully things like that will back under the auspices of Ravelry in the next couple of months. Don't get me started on the VAT mess. So there it is. This is called Remember, and the reason I'm showing it to you now is partly because I'm flogging it and partly because I want people to know that it's out there, but I want to give some copies of the pattern away. I'm going to give 3 copies of the pattern away, and I'm going to start a thread on the group which will be up and running by the time this processes and uploads. It'll be called the Remember Giveaway thread, and what I want you to do is I want you to tell me a story about what you want to knit this to help you remember. Who or what will you be remembering? It can be a person, can be an event, can be anything you like. A happy story, a sad story, I don't mind. Why will you be wanting to remember the thing you want to remember, and what is it? That's what I want you to share with me. Obviously, only if you're happy to and feel comfortable sharing. I'm not going to randomly pick a winner. I'm really going to choose the one that affects me the most, choose the 3 that affect me the most, be that in a sad way or in a happy way, whatever makes me laugh. Who or what do you want to remember and why when you knit this cowl? So there we are. That's my first giveaway. I hope it's successful. I hope people actually want it enough to enter for it. That'd be horribly embarrassing. Well, I said I was going to give away 3, but only one of you wanted it, so you get it by default. I'm hoping that's not going to be the case. I think I've whittled on, warbled on, burbled on, prattled on for far too long already today, so I'm going to sign off now. As I said, you can find me on Instagram and Twitter as Sockmatician. I'm Ravelry as Sockmatician. Head over to the group. Join the group, subscribe here on YouTube, say hello, make yourself known to me. I always love hearing from you, and I look forward to seeing you next time. Thanks very much. Goodbye.